Pulse 95. Between local lines. Notes from the Emirate.
Pulse 95. Notes from the Emirate, indeed. And one thing that we've got to understand is the COVID-19 scenario here in the United Arab Emirates. Now, we are gearing up for the crackdown on the virus, so with the vaccine and the number of vaccination and the figures here in the country are on the rise. It's getting very difficult even to get your appointments to get yourself vaccinated. It just goes to show how popular it is amongst the general public. But now, social distancing measures are in place again. Now, in Abu Dhabi, there is going to be a reduced attendance at the workplace in Abu Dhabi government and semi-government entities down to 30%. All jobs that could be delivered fully from outside the workplace will be entitled for the remote working, employees older than 60, people of determination, as well as people with those chronic diseases. It all comes into effect today.
Certainly does. So the attendance of government and semi-government offices has been reduced to 30%, in line with precautionary measures implemented in Abu Dhabi to protect the health of employees and their families and halt the spread of COVID-19 as well. The authority also announced remote working for all jobs that can be delivered fully from outside the workplace, and also advised employees over the age of 60 and those with chronic diseases and weak immunities to work from home. Now, regarding the compulsory COVID tests for unvaccinated staff in the Emirate, all employees who have not yet taken the COVID vaccine in Abu Dhabi must undergo a PCR test for COVID-19 every 7 days. And quote, according to Abu Dhabi's media office, volunteers in vaccine clinical trials and those vaccinated as part of the national vaccination programs who have active icons on Al-Husn apps are exempted from the weekly tests. We're looking at other changes as well in the capital. Over the weekend, cinemas were ordered shut until further notice. Malls asked to function at 40% capacity as a precautionary measure in line with COVID-19. And that's what a lot of people have been discussing as well. We've seen a slew of measures taking place in the neighboring Emirate and around Sharjah as well.
Yes, it is. Look, a couple of measures that they're going to be taking place include the introduction, the building of the field hospital in the Emirate of Sharjah. And the UAE has been quite well in ensuring that the social distancing measures are in place as well. And what we do need to understand is the number of cases are rising at the figure of around 3,000, so it's not a joke. You know, it is still out there, and we are prepared in the country for this scenario, and it's got even more worrying because we've seen people within our own circles now getting infected with the virus, and especially with this new variant of South Africa and England and the United Kingdom being in the limelight. Recently, and yesterday in fact, we saw cases were quite high. But one interesting aspect that we shouldn't ignore is the number of deaths that are taking place is a lot higher than we were used to. They've been above in double figures at the moment, above 10, 12 yesterday, and 914 people have tragically lost their lives here in the United Arab Emirates. And really, is important to consider that, because that figure is a huge figure given how young of a population we have and how small the community is in the United Arab Emirates. Literally everyone knows each other, and to have that figure, it's pretty alarming. So that's why it's not to be taken very lightly at all.
Not at all. And with the number of cases going up as well, the UAE's Ministry of Health and Prevention has refocused its vaccination efforts and dedicated its vaccination centers almost strictly to elderly people and those with chronic diseases to protect those vulnerable segments of the population during this spike of COVID-19 infections. The ministry said that over 4 to 6 weeks, the vaccine rollout will be focused on groups that are most vulnerable to COVID-19. And if you're not within these groups, you're going to have to make a prior appointment with your local vaccination center across the country as well. The ministry also called upon the families of elderly people and those with chronic diseases to ensure their vaccination and protect their health. And yes, it's definitely important to shed light on the number of deaths we've seen from COVID-19, and really goes to show that you can't just assume that, hey, I'm young, I'm going to be okay. Even if I get it, I'm not going to be as careful as I could be, because you're endangering the lives of others. And if you do contract COVID-19 and spread it to the wrong person, their whole life might get turned around. So it's pretty important here to be mindful of that and be considerate of others and to follow the precautionary measures as well.
Yep, of course. And I think a lot of people are hoping to get their e-sign on the Al-Hosn app. So as soon as you get your second dose of the vaccine, 21 days later and following on from that, you get the e-sign, which gives you easy access into the nation's capital, Abu Dhabi, for sure. And then you're not entitled to be to do the PCR tests on a regular basis, because at the moment in the nation's capital as well, and certainly some companies are now ensuring this, that people take the PCR test every 7 days. The e-sign exempts a resident from taking certain mandatory PCR tests, and unvaccinated employees of the federal government are required to take the PCR test every 7 days. And so we will be gearing up for this and looking forward to the vaccine drive here at Sharjah Broadcasting Authority. 9th of February is the date for many, and we're all anxiously waiting to get our second dose and then get and then really ensure that our efforts against the spread of COVID-19 are strengthened. Well, stay with us here on the Morning Majlis. Let us know on the text lines 4215 what extra precautionary measures you are taking to ensure that you are safe from this virus. We shall be right back after a bit of a short break, and we'll continue the discussions from there on. This is The Morning Majlis on Pulse 95. Up next is the female leader of the World Trade Organization. We'll be right back after some more musical entertainment here on Pulse 95.
Join the conversation with The Morning Majlis, Pulse 95.
Well, the path has been cleared, and the World Trade Organization is set to have its first woman and first person of African descent to lead the organization after South Korea's candidate pulled out of the race for the job. So Nigeria's Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala is going to be the first woman African leader of the World Trade Organization. And Iwalia is an economist and former finance minister of Nigeria, and had already enjoyed broad support from World Trade Organization members, including the European Union, China, Japan, and Australia. And certainly a big development and a major milestone as well.
Yes, it definitely is a massive milestone for sure, because 66 years of age, and a Nigerian-American economist and international development expert, sits on the board of Standard Chartered Bank, Twitter, Global Alliances for Vaccines and Immunization, and is also at the African Risk Capacity as well, has served as the Finance Minister of Nigeria under both the presidents, and has also been a managing director for operations. Spent 25 years in the World Bank. Come on, if there was no one else fit for this role, given the CV, I don't understand why people, there were some obstacles for this as well in the first place. Now, we're looking towards working with the new WTO Director General, is what a lot of people are saying at this stage. And she is going to be the first African and the first woman to run the Geneva-based trade body. The Biden administration's decision to support her will be viewed in Geneva as a welcome shift in the U.S. support for the multilateral trading system, following the 4 years under Donald Trump, which called it the worst trade deal the U.S. has ever signed. With the U.S. now joining a consensus, WTO General Counsel Chairman David Walker is expected to soon announce a meeting in Geneva where the organization's member will formally approve Ms. Okonjo-Iweala's appointment to a four-year term as Director General. And she did express her gratitude for the amount of support from the United States on her Twitter feed as well.
Yeah, very positive to see the United States joining everybody else on board, because before that, under the Trump administration, they favored a different candidate, Yoo Myung-hee from South Korea, the South Korean trade minister. But now she's withdrawn, and the United States is set to appoint a new trade representative as well. So that's what's going to happen. And look, the World Trade Organization has been tasked with promoting free trade, but it's been without a permanent director general since Roberto Azevedo stepped down a year earlier than planned at the end of August. And that was a pretty tough time. The WTO was caught up in the middle of that trade war between the United States and China at the time. Trump was a pretty vocal critic of the World Trade Organization and reportedly undermined its standing by imposing tariffs on Canada, Mexico, China, and the European Union as well. That's a lot of tariffs. But now Okonjo-Iweala will thus assume control of the organization that has struggled to prevent the trade spats between its neighbors. And U.S. President Joe Biden really looking like he's taken all the steps to restore support for multilateral institutions like the WTO. He is reportedly, however, expected to proceed with caution when it comes to signing any new trade deals. But certainly all eyes are on Joe Biden, who is essentially a different face for the United States and putting diplomacy back at the center of U.S. foreign policy as well.
Definitely is. I think he recently had one of those fireside chats moment as well. Good old Joe Biden speaking directly to the Americans, had a phone call with someone who recently lost a job at a startup. So really, we'll be seeing a fresh new perspective from the new president of the United States for sure. But now, with this new WTO director general, I think the big divide that we've seen of the North and South divide, the global South feeling marginalized in the international trade, this is going to be a refresher to see the first woman and the first African also at the helm of things when it comes to the global trade. So it'll be very interesting to see how her tenure operates. She did say that she is going to be focusing on a lot of to make it more be an active role as Director General and act as a sounding board to try to find common ground among the trade bodies memberships as well. So we will keep you posted about what's going on. For the time being, we'll take a bit of a break, and after some musical entertainment, we have the sports headlines courtesy of Emmanuel Majali, and we shall return right after that, continuing the discussions here on the Morning Majlis. Stay tuned to Pulse 95.
Pulse 95. Between local lines, notes from the Emirate.
Well, let's talk about photography, because Sharjah is set to see one of the world's most renowned international photography festivals, The Exposure, take place this week, starting from the 10th Wednesday to the 13th. And this event is for everyone, really. Whether you're an amateur photographer, a professional in the industry, or someone who sees photography as a hobby or just something that you like to look at, this festival will gather all of those people, with 400 UAE-based and international photographers present at the event, showing a selection of their works through 54 exhibitions, 41 solo and 13 group displays, and over 1,500 extraordinary images that will be showcased during this four-day event. And there's going to be so much happening: workshops, talks, seminars, and exhibitions across the board. And of course, the live Pulse 95 show.
That's the most interesting aspect for sure. I mean, yes, we have the 54 exhibitions, 41 solo and 13 group displays, but a live broadcast of Pulse 95 and a chance to catch up with most of our presenters is a huge selling point for sure. The exposure itself, now it seeks to inform, expand awareness and also delight the audience of the country by showcasing a diverse range of artistic and experimental work that explores social, humanitarian, environmental, cultural, gender, and other issues impacting mankind today. The solo and group exhibitions will offer unique perspectives on the evocative beauty of portraiture, sports, architecture, landscapes, and many more in a variety of formats that elevate the visual medium of storytelling. Now, one of the best reasons for going down to the Exposure Photography Festival is the direct access that you get. All these renowned photographers or renowned media figures, yes, they're going to be running their own workshops and campaigns and those dialogue sessions, but you as a visitor get a chance to have a one-on-one meeting with them, because they're so accessible. at the event. And look, photography, regardless of how well your camera is and your the lenses that you get, it's not always just the camera, it is the skill that you can master. Similar to how you do the off-road driving of your vehicles, it's not down to the car, it's down to your own abilities and skills and what you can do as an editor as well for those pictures that you've snapped. And to learn to have this endless experience and endless access, or limitless access, to these individuals, to learn from them, it's just a brilliant destination to do. And then a couple of big photographers that are going to be there, such as Mohammed Mohsen. He's the two-time Pulitzer Prize winner. His search for the stories that have never been told and the voices that have never been heard have culminated in this series of images that documents the world refugee crisis, with a spotlight on the real victims of conflict, such as the children. These images now become their voice to the outside world. And then loads more interesting photographers with their concepts coming down to exposure.
Oh, absolutely. And an exhibition I'm looking forward to is called Animosity: Human Wildlife Conflict Through the Lens of Aaron Gakoski. And it's an exhibition that sheds light on harmful practices towards animals, including the hunting, poaching, and exploitation of animals taking place across the world. And this was documented by environmental photojournalist Aaron Gakoski, telling a story of the world's wildlife in crisis through his haunting and beautiful imagery that documents humans' complex relationship with wildlife. We're also going to be seeing photography by Paula Bronstein about Afghanistan, Between Hope and Fear, an exhibition that is essentially an eloquent portrait of everyday life in Afghanistan, and a photojournalism work that documents the challenges facing the country today in terms of poverty and instability, but also sheds and shines light on some new hope in the region as well. And certainly shows just how powerful photography can be in resonating with people emotionally and even spurring social change.
Another interesting exhibition I'm looking forward to is something that is very close to here in the United Arab Emirates. Abdullah Al-Bukhaysh's Cities of Happiness is something that is going to be looking at the love for architecture. So it's based, of course, here in the country. Another one is a friend off the show and a person who is very well known amongst the photography all the photographers here in the United Arab Emirates is Ashok Varma. His work focuses on the pandemic in COVID-19, UAE Fights Back. And he works for local publishing companies here in the United Arab Emirates, and his work continues to document the news of the country. So that is going to be another interesting exhibition to be part of. Another one that I'm liking and looking forward to is Falconry and the Arab Influence by Brent Sturton. It explores the practice of falconry in the Arab region. So many more to get a chance to catch and understand and learn a lot more from.
Yeah, it's pretty loaded as far as the program is concerned. There's also going to be the works of photographic societies and organizations. There'll be 14 group exhibitions featuring a choice selection of images from Sharjah Shine's exhibition, the Union of Arab Photographers, and the Exposure Photography Awards, to name a few. So there's going to be a lot of photography as well. And as an art form, it's pretty interesting. I mean, everybody is technically a photographer. You've got a phone camera, and you put up your phone and take a picture. You're making so many choices, whether you feel it or not, whether how far into the subject are you zooming in, how much of the background environment are you showcasing, which aspects of the person's physicality are you showing, or the subject or the animal that you're photographing. And every choice you make has an impact on the viewer in one way or another. And what they'll be talking about during these seminars and talks and workshops is how to manipulate those variables to create that maximum impact in the viewer and tell an engaging and compelling story with a single photograph. So it's a fascinating art, and this event will thoroughly delve into it all, and we'll be there for you during our live coverage, Pulse 95, from Feb 10 to 13th, walking you through those workshops, walking you through this craft, and talking to some of the most renowned experts and photographers in this field to tell us a little bit about what they do and how they tell those fascinating stories as well. So it's definitely not an event to miss.
Definitely not. It's a massive four-day festival to look forward to indeed. So do stay with us here on the Morning Majlis on Pulse 95 to learn a lot more about such events and what's happening here in the Emirate of Sharjah. We'll be right back after the World of News headlines and we'll continue the discussions from there on. Stay with us. This is the Morning Majlis only on Pulse 95.
Join the conversation with the Morning Majlis, Pulse 95.
Text us at 4215 to join the conversation. And we're discussing the UAE's Mars mission, the first interplanetary exploration undertaken by an Arab country. And the space mission has announced that it will enter Mars orbit on Tuesday this week at 7:42 p.m. local time. Now, after successfully completing its seven-month cruise to Mars, the UAE Mars Mission Hope Probe, it's just days away from the most critical part of its historic voyage to the Red Planet. That's the critical maneuver that will define the success or failure of the mission to place its orbiter in Mars's orbit. The Mars orbital insertion maneuver involves the reversal of the spacecraft and firing of the Hope Probe's six Delta V thrusters in a 27-minute deceleration burn to rapidly slow the speed of the spacecraft from 121,000 kilometers per hour to 18,000 kilometers per hour. And we'll see the operations team confirming whether the probe has successfully achieved a stable capture orbit around Mars.
Yeah, and look, it's just got a modest 5 million kilometers left to cover at the stage. It has covered over 475 million kilometers since its ascent and liftoff. The probe is carrying the dreams of millions of Emiratis, Arabs and expatriates in the country, and it is scheduled to enter the Martian orbit by the 9th of February at around 7:42 p.m. UAE time. Now, a number of journalists have been accredited to head on over to the Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center, so if you are going to be tuning in, you are going to be bombarded with thousands of videos of celebrations for the Hope Probe's Mars orbit insertion. This is the most critical phase of the mission, and it is expected to last 27 minutes, and it is going to be the witnessing the dream of a nation entering the dark half hour on the 9th of February 2021. It is going to be the a very historic moment to see it's arriving, and the Hope Probe approaches Mars with such a velocity that it will slingshot around it and continue into deep space if it isn't slowed down to the level that it can be captured by Mars's gravity. And this is going to be the very, very crucial time for the Hope Probe as well.
Yeah, an incredible story for the United Arab Emirates. This project was conceived in 2014 as a way to inspire young Emiratis, and as a bold way to celebrate the country's 50th anniversary by the end of 2021, we've come a long way, and it's a major win for the country. The fact that this scientific program, this technological acceleration, has all taken place within such a short period of time as well, and certainly an incredible mission as well, and really all everyone's just sort of eyeing what's going to happen on Tuesday, because when it makes that critical descent and enters Mars's orbit, it's going to be a major, major success for us here and a major milestone for us as well. And this story has certainly inspired a lot within the country to take up STEM subjects in science and technology, and looking beyond the stars as far as our ambition and our goals for the future.
Yeah, Umran Sharaf, the project director of the Emirates Mars mission, spoke to local media and said that, look, the Mars orbit insertion is one of the riskiest phases of the mission. The main reason behind it is because it's going to be for the first time that they use this system and platform that has been developed for deep space to perform this operation for a very long time. This will be the first time the spacecraft system will be tested for nearly 30 minutes. minutes straight. So it is going to be a very interesting to see what's going to happen. The previous critical phase was the launch phase, where they used the MHI launcher and a launcher that has heritage and success rate. But this one, the Mars orbit insertion, it does have a success rate of 50%. So it is very, very critical. So it is going to boil down to how the descent does take place. So it is a lot of hope that this probe is carrying, and we're really hoping for a very, very successful mission. And then this is going to be a very historic moment for the United Arab Emirates, also coinciding with the year that we will be celebrating 50 years since the Union. Well, stay with us here on the Morning Majlis. We'll take a bit of a short break, and when we do return, we're going to be focusing a little bit more on how Sharjah was shining with the Let's Majaz event, and Iraqi singers were there serenading the audience as well as people around the Majaz waterfront over the weekend. So we'll take a bit of a break now, and do stay tuned to Pulse 95 and let us know if you were part of that festival over the weekend, celebrating all things Iraqi music. We'll be right back after some more musical entertainment on Pulse 95.
If you liked this episode of the Morning Majlis, drop a like and subscribe.
95.
Be sure to follow us on Instagram for all our daily updates and top stories.
Pulse.